ban on the blue side, but that definitely lends into what you were saying about Fox Deity.
Yeah, yeah, they don't want to put this Fox Deity on a carry top because he likes to play those. So Jace is arguably one of the strongest picks in this patch as well, especially with the lethality changes. You could definitely first pick Jace, but if you don't want to first pick him, you just take him off the board, and then you know you don't give it over to Fox, because if you want, you know, if you want the Varus or you want the Kha'Zix, then you're going to give up the Jace.
Yeah.
And if this guy is a carry top laner, just don't give up the Jace.
Yeah. Don't give him what
don't
he wants.
Don't give him what he wants.
Interesting as well that we see a Katarina banned out here, especially when GLB are not only getting the first pick, but also have Vrow on the side,
yeah,
who is more than happy to go off on a Katarina.
Okay. I mean, I wasn't expecting the Quinn ban, but...
I think that's a target ban to specifically Delito.
Okay. Fair enough.
This happened... it was either last week or the week before or something, and we were kind of like perplexed on the Quinn ban. I'm 90% sure it's a Delito.
I mean, it has to be a target ban. It's not a meta ban, let's be real. But I mean, you leave open the Rengar if you don't ban him here. And I mean, we have seen people do this because they then, you know, they're saying, okay, if you want to pick Rengar here, we'll pick Varus and we'll pick Kha'Zix. And we're okay playing Kha'Zix into Rengar. So we have seen people just skip the Rengar ban if they really don't want to do it. And we have also seen not a lot of people play Rengar, although this guy's just locked it in. So not too surprising as far as the meta goes to see this Rengar lock in. But, I mean, I'm a bit, yeah, I would say, you know, maybe just want to take him away. But you got him, so that's fine. If you're okay giving up Varus because he's really strong right now, that's fine as well. You might want to pick your AD carry here too, most likely the Jhin, if you want to prioritize that. Because, you know, if you don't want to give away your hand, you know, if you pick one of your mids or something or your support, you might give that away. They're not going for the Jhin, they're going for the Ashe instead. Oh, there it is. There is the Jhin.
Yeah,
okay,
so
fair enough.
Got the prediction right in the end. So now, on this side of GLB, now that the Rengar has been locked in, you already said... probably fair to play Kha'Zix.
I think Kha'Zix...
Hovering and Nidalee, we'll talk about that if it gets locked in.
Yeah.
What else would you... Oh, okay, Hecarim. That makes sense. We have seen a lot of Hecarim
in
the Premiership
his pocket
specifically.
Pick, yeah. He's good at Hecarim.
What do you do with this last pick now? Do you look towards the support role?
I think you probably go support because you want priority on that. Zyra's still open. Malzahar, if you want it. Shen's also a very good top laner, but, you know, I mean, this deity guy doesn't really play much Shen, at least... He prefers to play the carry tops, you know, the Jace, the Rumble, Trundle against tanks as well, we've seen as well. We could even see Fiora. That's something which we've seen a lot of priority on in the UK Prem too. So, or the ESL Prem, sorry, that was the wrong name. But, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of different things. You either want to prioritize like the Zyra or the Malzahar, or you want to take away the top, or you can just pick your mid laner as well. Orianna's a very safe mid laner, so as far as it goes, if you lock in Orianna, you can't really go too wrong. But this blows open the whole draft as far as the bans go. What do you do here? Like, you got, you know, normally you have similar things picked in the first three picks from both teams, and then you just target ban what you don't want to play against. Or you have, like, one difference between the two teams. So we do have, yeah, the mid has been picked by Pariah, so they'll probably ban mid laners, and with the top pick by GLB, you might see either top lane bans here, or because Pariah have the first pick in this second part of the draft, you might not want to see the Zyra, the Malzahar, or something like that as well. So...
And I mean, now we've got an interesting question of Vrow already has his top laner. They could look for a particularly favorable matchup, maybe get rid of something like, you know, a Maokai that's been such a staple pick within not only the meta, but specifically the Premiership. But do you want to ban away things like Maokai when you're against someone like Fox Deity, who you know doesn't really want to go into that kind of role? There's a lot of things kind of up in the air here.
Yeah.
Syndra and Lulu going to be banned away. Interested by the Lulu ban?
Yeah.
We've not seen huge amounts of Lulu, really.
That's a target ban of Rao. Rao's a very good, very, very good Taliyah. In my opinion, though, you can't target ban this guy out. I mean, Taliyah, he's exceptional at that champion, but he's just going to pick something else and pop off again. So hard to target ban someone that's as good as this guy is, in my opinion. But this first pick here could be a lot of different things. The Lulu ban would suggest that they might want the Malzahar, but it's confusing me that why they would necessarily leave Zyra up. Or maybe they picked Lulu for some other reason, like which we'll see in their picks coming out here. So you either want to secure, take away that support from GLB Esports, which we'll see with the Malzahar here, which I would expect to see is answered by Zyra. I feel like Zyra, people run Zyra into Malzahar and are completely happy with that because she does very well versus Malz. The Lulu ban is again someone who does well versus Malz, so there's that. But Misfortune, decent choice as well.
Yeah,
it works too against Malzahar.
I would assume that the Misfortune is an AD carry lock in here,
well,
purely because
Varus,
they are
so.
Picking. Oh,
so they can't.
Being, yeah,
I've done that a lot. Trust me, when I've seen Misfortune, I'm like, this is a flex pick. Oh wait, they've already picked their AD carry.
I was thinking, picking AD carry and support remaining, so pick AD carry on them. Yeah. They do already have the Varus, so now looking towards a mid laner, going up against an Orianna.
Yeah.
Corki. Notorious is like the safest mid laner ever. As you there say, Corki's still available. Are going to lock that one in. So, I mean, we've seen that mid lane a fair few times at this point, especially in professional play. How do you feel that lane pans out?
I mean, they're both really safe laners. That's why you pick them. So you pick Corki because you can run it into whatever you want, really. You pick Orianna because you can run it into whatever you want. So it's honestly, it's a really safe combination. And I think Varus Corki is a really nice combo of disgusting poke.
Yeah.
You do not want to play versus Varus Corki. And if they do look in this Maokai, for me, I think as far as like meta goes, this is that's fine. That's a good pick. You know, just pick the Maokai. That's cool. You can't go wrong with Maokai. Very strong top laner. But having Fox...
It's not his style.
No, it's
really.
Not his style.
It's
so.
Not the kind of thing you expect to see him going on.
Yeah.
Like, looking at the GLB composition now, you already mentioned the Corki and Varus kind of working really well together and the amount of long-range damage to do. Misfortune ultimate mixed in there as well. And then this massive front line of a Hecarim and a Shen. This is going to be a team that's incredibly difficult to engage on.
Oh, yeah. And they've got a lot of squishies on their side with the Corki, the Varus, and Misfortune. As far as supports go, Misfortune, no self-pill, really. No shields, anything like that. Not tanky. Malzahar has his Voidlings to block skill shots and also has the passive shield as well. So he's a bit more safe, but Misfortune, not so much. So the Shen shield can really help there as well. Or you can just do, like, that Shen ult onto the Hecarim as he charges in and just, like, blow open the team fight that way. So I think it's got a lot of potential from GLB Esports to play the game how they want to play it, really. You know, you poke them down and then Hecarim pops ghost, pops his E and just like blasts in, and then there's Shen as well, and then you just wipe them out, or you can have Misfortune, you know, with the ulti to back off as well. So I like GLB's comp, to be honest. I like it.
Okay, we'll talk a little bit more about compositions as we get into game, but you guys at home have been voting on Twitter for who you think is going to be able to take this one. There's a 71% vote in favor of GLB Paria. Not got the massive amount of fans backing them on this one. So GLB definitely the fan favorite. I'm going to turn to you, Dan. Do you think it's going to be GLB here, or do you think it's going to be Paria?
I think the fans have got it on this one. I think GLB is probably going to take this one away. I like seeing Vrow and Corki as well, and I like the comp overall. I think GLB is a better team.
Okay, well, I think I'm going to agree with you on this one. Both going to go with the GLB prediction as we head into this best of two series. These guys are going to be loading into the Rift as well. Now, we'll go back to our conversation of compositions, because we've talked a lot about GLB, not really talked about the Paria draft. Now, you already mentioned how, you know, they've got the Shen in the draft for GLB, which is really going to alleviate the fact that there's so many squishy targets, but they are against a Rengar. Revels against a composition full of squishies.
Yeah, you don't really want to be playing a squishy against Rengar. If you're an AD carry main, then Rengar ban is probably your number one ban in solo queue. To be fair, though, the Hecarim is also very hard to play against as an AD carry. Someone who's just, like, ridiculously fast, who you can't get rid of, and also does a bit too much damage considering how tanky they become later on. This is not going to be a fun game to play if you're a squishy, and there is a bit of protection there. At least you got the Shen ult, you got stuff like that, you got the Orianna shield as well, so from both teams they can protect their squishies a little bit, but it's still going to be a tough game to play, in my opinion, if you're a squishy. And thank god I'm a jungle main, so I don't have to go through these pains, because this stuff hurts. I can tell you, as someone who's played Rengar and Hecarim used to be my one trick this season as well, it's you do make the squishies cry a little bit. So
yeah. It's definitely a powerful pick in this specific patch. We're ready to get onto the Rift. Sorry about the slight delay getting onto the Rift there. No actions kicked off just yet, though, on this one. Was just double-checking all the key bindings, making sure everything is A-OK before we jump on into the match. But it is GLB on our blue side up against Paria on our red side. Battle for the bottom of the table here. And both Paria and GLB, more than anything at this stage, playing for their pride and playing to really show who they are, you know, show that while they are right now at the bottom of the table, they don't intend to stay there for the rest of the season.
Yeah, definitely. And I think GLB have a lot to prove. They've got a lot of, in my opinion, they have some superstar players, in specifically Vrow. I think Delito can bring it as well if he steps up. And, you know, I'm really interested to see if they can translate that, because you would think against a team like Paria, arguably one of the weaker teams in the Prem, that if your superstars are going to shine, this would be a game where they would shine. So, interested to see what happens here.
Yeah, I mean, I think you bring up a really good point there in that, yes, this is the game that you pretty much have to win. If you want to avoid the bottom of the table, it's like when you're fighting for first seed, right? You have to beat your direct opponent. You have to beat the other person that's right up at the top. Same with the bottom of the table. If you do not want to finish last place, this is an incredibly important match for you. So we'll see whether they can prove themselves here. I will point out as well, we neglected to mention during when we were talking about the rosters, Berserker, that is in fact Lemon Knight. There hasn't been a roster change for GLB. That is the same player that they've had in AD carry role for the whole season. He has just changed his name to Berserker.
I'm really interested to see how these junglers are parting here, if they're going to do something aggressive, because Hecarim's gone for like a full clear to the top side, which is not that peculiar to see, but it does mean that there's not going to be any early pressure. But Rengar, on the other hand, is in a position to potentially do something, except Rengar is not particularly good in the early game. So if he could still sneak in and find something, but honestly, with the lanes being how they are, the lane matchups, there's not really any specific good lane to gank unless it's top lane. So I would be a bit surprised to see much action coming out of the junglers, honestly, in this early game. So we might just have a really boring, like, first 5-10 minutes, and maybe even a power farm to level 6 from Rengar, and even Hecarim as well. Like, at level 6, that guy unlocks a new gear, so probably not too much going on here.
Yeah, and I mean, that's something we've seen quite a lot of, not just in the Premiership, in Europe in general. It's very slow early games, and then once you start to hit some power spikes, then trying to abuse those, make advantages out of that. And especially when we look at things like Corki in the mid lane as well, that's a champion that has been renowned for years of relying on that power spike when he gets his Trinity Force. So you would expect that GLB are going to be waiting for that kind of opportunity.
Yeah, and when we see this mid lane, there's a lot of trades going down here, which I really like to see, because you pick Orianna and you pick Corki when you want to have safe lane phases. You don't pick these guys to necessarily go aggressive and destroy the lane and, you know, make your enemy laner's life hell. So whenever we're just scouring back to them and they're just going at it and fighting, I love to see that. Like, look at this. They're just going ham all the time. It's beautiful. These are the safest laners in the game, and they're still making it happen. And that's what we want to see out of these guys. Especially Rao, you know, this guy who... If you're the superstar of your team and you're playing against the worst team in the league, you've got to step up. So I like how we're starting the game.
Well, Toxic Dare's going top as Trilip goes bot, or Trilipe, sorry, I should say, joke. Actually, in a lot of trouble. Loke, sorry, will walk away. Apparently, I can't get any names right, but Trilipe.
It's happening top as well.
Very little HP. It's going to be Delito getting underneath his tower there.
Yeah.
So I believe all of the action has subsided just before that pause came in. Berserker actually suffering from a disconnect. So hopefully should be able to get back on ASAP.
That's a pretty obvious one right here. You saw Rengar attack an enemy champion, and that champion is still alive. So that's probably the bug we're experiencing here. Rengar, of course, not known for leaving people alive when he goes on them. So,
see, this is the thing we talked about it earlier. It wasn't level 6 yet.
Yeah, so that's true, actually.
Doesn't one-shot everyone
true.
Just yet.
Only one longsword. He needs to get a few more stacks before he has 6,000 attack damage. Yeah, that's true. My bad.
Once he's got the four long swords along with his boots in his pot, then we'll be looking
That's
at a scary
needs.
Cat. But so hopefully we'll be able to get this pause resolved ASAP for you guys. Looking across the board, nothing too ridiculous standing out right now. There is a bit of a CS lead in the bottom lane, though. Berserker actually with a 10 CS lead over Loke at this early stage. Obviously, I don't want to stress on it too much, because when it's very early in laning, often I can't really see on the minimap right now. It might just be a big wave pushing towards Loke. But, you know, is that something to do with the Varus Jhin matchup, perhaps?
I mean, Misfortune is known as someone that is tricky for Malzahar to handle in lanes. He's very good against the Voidlings. He pops the passive shield very well, too. I mean, at this stage, you'd expect things to be more or less equal. I mean, at level 3, not too much happens, to be honest. So what is interesting, though, is that if Varus does get a lead here, not only is Poke very hard to play against when you're from behind, but also he starts with a longsword, which means that if he wants to rush into the lethality build, he will get that faster than Jhin will, who started with the Doran's Blade.
Yeah, and that is kind of that notorious telltale sign of, I am going for the lethality build. It's going for that longsword and three pots. And We've all seen recently how strong Varus can be with that lethality build. The damage, even once you're just hitting like level 9 and you've got one or two items, just the sheer damage you can do with that build is absolutely terrifying. Luke really having a hard time underneath the tower here, and looks like this CS lead might just stay maintained if they can keep the poke down. They should be able to deny this CS.
Look how far back this guy has to play against Jin. Against Varus. It's so difficult. The gank by Trilight, that's his name, right?
Trilight.
The gank by Trilight was really smart because he ganked as a huge wave was crashing under the tower, which put a huge amount of pressure onto Loke to... He took so much damage and now he can't CS the wave, and now, you know, this CS lead that we were talking about, you said it could just be a big minion wave, which it was, is actually now something a lot more than that, because the pressure from Hecarim gave him a lot of trouble under that tower when he went to come CS later on.
Yeah, a good presence of mind there as well from Trilight to understand that is what needed to happen to really glean himself or his team an advantage. And, you know, that's one of the things that people often forget is... I mean, you're an expert on this. Jungling isn't just about going into lanes and getting kills. Pressure is arguably the most important part of jungle.
Yeah, it's about walking into your enemy, into the enemy lane, going for a gank, having your ally not respond, giving double buff to the enemy team, then question mark pinging your allies. That's what jungling is all about. We haven't seen any of that today. A little bit disappointed, but we still got some games left in the tanks, and maybe that'll come through.
Yeah, looking forward to some heavy question mark pinging later on in the game when we start to see teams lose team fights and start to get tilted.
Yeah. Well, I kind of liked about the take from gank, by the way. Oh, here we go. It's gone in.
Yeah, good bit of damage coming out from Paria there. Obviously angry about the amount of pressure that Berserk has been putting out onto them, but can't really turn it into anything major right now.
No, but that if you've got a huge minion wave, that is a good time to go aggressive, because at this stage of the game, early on, you can't fight 2v2 if you have loads of minions against you as well. So it's a nice time to go aggro there and to put pressure on them without really risking having anything come back your way either.
Yeah, and I think as well in that situation, if you're against the Varus, you're just happy to be able to push the wave in.
Yeah.
Because Varus is so difficult to push against, especially when he starts to stack up some long swords. You can already see that he's got that tier and a couple in the bank.
That tier is going to mean a lot of key spams from Varus, so that's as soon as that happens, it's a very hard time playing against this guy.
Well, Vrow could be in a bit of trouble here.
Rengar is level 6.
Toxic waiting on the sideline. As you say, is level 6. The minion wave will push up, but they're deciding this isn't something they can go for just yet. I think Vrow basically decided, oh.
This could be good, bot lane.
Yeah, here we go, Loke. Actually in a lot of trouble, already slowed down. Misses the ultimate, but that does not matter. Berserker gets the last hit, and that is first blood easily picked up by GLB.
Yeah, that was good. I said it might just be a level 6 farm from both these junglers, and there you have it. Easy peasy lemon squeezy. First kill of the game. That ultimate misses, but if he puts it that far back, that's the best place to put it, because even if Loke flashes back to try and survive towards his tower, he's still going to get hit. If he runs into your tower, you'll miss your ult, but he's dead anyway. So pretty smart. A nice reaction here from Rengar as well, and as we're seeing Trilipe as well trying to get it through too. If you see the enemy jungler on one side of the map, that opens up the other side of the map for you to invade, for you to take things away, because you never want the enemy jungler to create pressure and you never give anything back, because that's how teams gain advantages. So Rengar goes into Hecarim's jungle here, takes away the whole top side of the jungle, and he's like, Hecarim, mate, if you're going to be naughty to my bot lane, I was going to say a word there, I don't think I'm allowed to say on stream, then I'm going to take your top side jungle.
Yeah, and I mean, you're absolutely right, Toxic, making sure that he takes advantage of that situation, but all things considered, the kill was the most important thing, and that did go the way of GLB in the end. So they're starting to increase the gold lead just ever so slightly, 1,500 in their favor. It's nothing too crazy, but it's certainly a good starting point for the team.
Absolutely. I'm actually quite interested about the Hecarim's item build. No boots at 10 minutes. He's invested like almost 2,000 gold worth of items and no shoes to show for himself. So that's an interesting one. Hecarim's very good with move speed, but it's not like what he's got is bad. They're still good items, you just don't usually see them get prioritized over the boots.
I mean, considering his passive is turning movement speed into AD,
yeah,
you generally see the boots very early on the Hecarim. Yeah. Just in junglers in general, Snuggly rooted up here. Doesn't mean he takes a couple of extra hits from the Voidlings, but AD carry will keep him alive. Here we go, though. All in coming out. Chains of Corruption landing. There is the rain of bullets coming through. But Barnabas cancels that with his own ultimate.
Here comes the dive.
A whole bunch of traded ultimates. Now Vrow and Trilipe looking to turn this into more rockets coming out galore. Here comes the package. Loke trying to get away with his life. Doesn't have summoners though. Barnabas now the next target. Delito stuck underneath the tower. Has to flash away, but will walk away with his life. Shockwave only onto Berserker. He flashes. Deity can't follow and will go down. Vrow grabs that one. It's a 2-0.
Yeah, that was a really good team play right there. I really liked how they did that. The Chanel was a little bit late, honestly, but oh, he's going back in.
Toxic truly does dare that one, going in 1v3. Does have to just run away with it. Has the CC immunity, though, so gets away with his life. Yeah. This will surely be first tower going the way of GLB, though.
Yeah, you think so. I mean, Corki doesn't... He's not rushing the Triforce. Corki with Triforce pushes a lot faster, obviously, because of the Sheen, but... Still, look at this guy.
Going pretty ham for this one. It's going to be able to shred that armor. Curtain Call coming out, though, and empowered auto attacks are a thing that exist. In the meantime, the Dragon will go the way of GLB. It was an Infernal Drake, which, you know, very big pickup for them, but I've got to say, Vrow...
Bit too much.
Why, mate?
Bit too much there. I mean, honestly, this is the part where if you're in TeamSpeak and Vrow's just like, it's all right, boys, you take that Fire Dragon, I'll sacrifice myself for it. Totally worth it. That was an intentional play to secure the Fire Dragon.
Yeah, 100%. 100% intentional there. So, interesting play, especially considering we've been singing Vrow's praises this entire, like, all through Champions Select. Like, before the game, we were saying, you know, Vrow is the guy to look out for. Not really living up to that in that specific situation, but I guess he thought everyone had already based at that stage.
Yeah, I mean, he's just a bit hypey, I guess. You make a play like that, and you get the advantage in the bot lane, and then you just go for it.
Fox Deity could be in trouble here. Trilipe gonna look to go in. Nice flash from Fox, though. Denies the knockback from that Horsey. And in the meantime, that is going to open up this bottom lane to push as hard as they can, try and get that tower. Oh, solo kill in the mid lane, though. Vrow basically looking to shut me up, as far as I can tell. Deity should be going down. He can is the answer. The minions will soak up the rest of the aggro, but just trading one for one there is great for Fox Deity.
Yeah, that's not bad at all, to be honest. But if you lose the tower here as well, that's not great. But you're getting bot tower, so it's kind of a trade there. The minion block getting a bit of an assist on that Shen kill, can't help but feel like. And obviously, as we can see, we never should have doubted our Lord and Savior, Vrow, who obviously made that aggressive play earlier just to get over and summon us so that he could then go in and kill her afterwards.
Yeah, it was in fact all calculated. He was setting up for this solo kill in the mid-lane.
Maybe we should call a play like that Vrowculated.
Oh, God.
Oh, you're regretting me inviting you already. Puns. 12 minutes into the first game, you regret me being here.
Speaking of Vrow, he is in between a rock and a hard place. Has to flash as well as Vaunt there. Did get the stand united from Delito. There goes his last defensive summoner. But as you say, is a very, very safe mid laner. Rift Herald will be picked up in the end by Trilipe. And I didn't actually see, I think they gave that over to Delito in the end. So
that's going to be really annoying to play against. I mean, a Shen with... I mean, it could be worse. Like, if this Shen was like a Fiora or something like that, then you really don't want to see the Rift Herald on someone like that who can genuinely really bully you in the 1v1. But we already know Fox Deity is not a particularly comfortable tank player. So if you stick him in that 1v1 against Alito, who in my opinion is a good top laner and is comfortable in his Shen pick, very comfortable in that Shen pick, then give him Rift Herald as well, and it's just a bit unfair, really.
Yeah, it's certainly looking like a matchup that is very much in favor of Delito right now. Let's take a look at the gold differences across the board. As we're not really seeing too many huge gaps opening up. You can see in the mid lane, there's a fairly large one, but it's all about the bottom lane right now because of that CS lead on top of the kill and two assists. He's starting to open up 1,500 gold. That was the lead that GLB had in total a few minutes ago, now extending that to 4,000.
I'm actually really impressed with how Trilipe is playing this game, because to be honest, I've had some criticisms about him when he's been playing some of the other teams. I think Vrow has really tried to do his best, but there's not so much you can do when you're not on the same page as your jungler or your jungler's not performing as well. But he's done really well this game, and I think, you know, you can just see the difference of having a jungler that's creating pressure on the map, what that does to you as a mid laner. Like, this, that Vrow can do whatever he wants right here. He can go as aggressive as he wants. When he killed Orianna, she was under her tower. And part of that is because Hecarim has pressure, and it means that Rengar can't just, like, camp Vrow and then do whatever he wants.
Well, Vrow, he's going to know that the kitty is coming. Look at the damage. Shockwave doesn't land, but it doesn't matter. It is still going to be Shicklin that manages to grab the kill for himself. Look, having to run away here. Truly doesn't get the knockback, though. Beautiful ultimate by Branibus. That is going to deny everything. Curtain Call coming on through. Second shot will land onto Berserker. Can they finish anything off? Snuggly tanking up as much as he can. That bullet time will surely deny the engage there from Toxic Dares.
That was a lot of good play right there, actually. That was really cool. That the Malzahar ult to stop the knockback, that was smart. The MF ult, especially if you're like a squishy person who doesn't have escapes and you're on the back foot running away, your instinct is just like, okay, I'm getting the crap out of here. But she stands her ground and puts her ult down to save her teammates. So that's good. I like that. That's smart. I'm surprised that Rengar can jump over the wall topside when he's in that bush, by the way, to finish off Rao. Like, that was crazy. I didn't know Rengar could jump that far, but he's pretty undertuned, so he needs a little bit extra.
I don't 100% know how the mechanic works, but if he starts the jump, I think he lands where you are when he finishes the jump. So I think he'd start the jump as the Valkyrie was going through, so he kind of got it extended, maybe.
Yeah.
I'm not 100% sure if that's how it works, but... Toxic Dares actually taking a huge amount of damage. Rao currently just 1v3.
It's not taking
comfortably.
Damage.
Look at the Voidlings just chunking him out, though. Kind of a punishment after the trade is already over. Meantime, a lot of pressure coming through in the bottom lane as the Baron isn't up yet. Let's remember, we're just 16 minutes into the game. It feels a lot later.
Yeah, it does. Can we just double check? Rao has the package now, right? I can't tell on that. Okay, he just used it.
He just used it, yeah.
I'm not familiar with that skin. I wasn't sure if that's the package animation or not, but... When that package is up...
Yeah, it's like a mystery box, I think.
Whoa!
Whoa! The big rocket damage coming on through Branibus is just obliterated on that one. And that should open up this bottom lane tower for another strong push coming out here. They're going to have to rotate some people down here. Unfortunately, Delito had just gone back to base. So they can't get too much pressure out across them.
I think his ult's up, though. So, and he's got TP, of course. So, like, if the red team... fights, if Briar fight, although of course Malzahar's dead, so it's probably not going to happen. But if he needs to join his team, he can still do it, but he's not, like you say, the pressure in the top lane would be really nice for him right here. To be honest, it might have been worth him TPing too. I don't know whether that would have been the optimal play there, but I mean, in hindsight, he could have probably done a lot of damage, especially with that Rift Herald to the tower, but...
Yeah, I mean, just the fact that everybody had to go down to that bottom lane, they had to gravitate down there, and then... Worst case scenario, someone else comes up towards the top lane, Fox has to TP to defend that tower, you just stand united to the bottom lane, finish off that tower.
Yeah.
Certainly, I mean, there's a lot of things you can say after a play and like kind of wonder what would have happened. It's very difficult to accurately say, but Delito now, he has got up to that top lane. Shadow Dash will be denied as the rest of the team from Pariah will collapse onto him. Delito, I don't think he gets away with his life here. It's Fox Deity that grabs the kill for himself.
And round
the
bot
lane. And in
the
meantime, Rao once again diving another tower.
As you do, casually. Look at Jin's body, by the way. Look at him.
Way, way behind this. Like, Rao went ham for that one. He didn't even have package. Let's remember, he just used the package about 2 minutes ago. So, Rao, I think I just need to keep the camera on Rao for the rest of this game. He's doing some crazy things.
Now, that's good, though. Like, even if Delito dies on the top side, it's nice to look at the minimap and see what his team is doing despite the fact he's dying. Because you always want to translate pressure.
Berserker actually having to flash away from the shockwave there. Could have been in a tricky spot. He was surrounded by Voidlings. I think he was getting a little bit minion blocked by that one. Sweeping away this brush, though. They're looking for a death brush. Fox Deity knows what's up, though. Throwing that sapling and actually looking for an engage. Curtain Call comes on through. Trileap, or Trilight. Going to be slowed down. Flash engage onto Berserker, though. Stand United will deny a lot of that damage. And now suddenly Deity, he's all on his own. Nobody else could follow through. And that's just going to be Trilight rooted, but it's not enough to capture anything.
Yeah, that's tough when you're playing from behind against people who have global ultimates. Because whenever you feel like you've got a window, suddenly, boom, the window disappears. You know, it's like playing against TF in solo queue. It's very frustrating. Unless you go up against Grow Score, then it's free. No, I shouldn't say that. But it's the concept of it. It's just if you're behind and playing against double TP, which was a meta a little while back, you don't see it so much anymore, but it was a thing back in the day. Or Shen, or TF. You find yourself a window, you're like, we got to take this, we're behind, let's go for it. Finally, something's happening. Oh, wait, no, it's not. And that happens. You get baited into something and you just die.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, that even happens in professional play as well. That's not just a solo queue thing. We see it a lot of the time in, like, over the last month, we certainly saw a situation where it was always Nautilus, Poppy, Maokai in the top lane. You'd see basically these teams battling for who could kill the tank the quickest and then who could sweep up the fight because of that. And if you were one of the top laners, it was kind of your job to just... What is that damage?
That is too much. That's what that is.
But yeah, it was kind of your job to just be able to soak up damage. And if you lost that fight, then you are just going to be left out to dry by your team.
Yeah, and good luck soaking up damage when you're behind as Maokai and the enemy support next item is Black Cleaver. That's not going to help, you know? That's not going to help. Especially, you know, if you're already behind, the Cleaver's going to shred your hole.
Here we go. Shikling will be just destroyed on that one. Delito does get locked up here. Maybe he'll go down to the tower, but Trilang looking to capitalize. Got one. Brown flashing for another kill, but can't get it. Gets rooted up as Toxic Days will be going back in. Curtain Call on top of everything else. That's a kill. Straight in for a mid lane tower, though.
Yeah, that was on the backside. Hecarim did a butt ton of damage to both Jhin and Malzahar there. I thought it was just Jhin, but then I realized Malzahar's body was also
one
there.
Shot.
Yeah, that was ridiculous. I mean, that's what happens if you get ahead on Hecarim. He's a jungler who rushes Triforce. Any jungler that rushes Triforce, if they get ahead and they get that Triforce early and then they get levels and stuff, that's hard. That's really hard to play against unless you've got good peel. And this team doesn't have good peel, really. They don't have much to keep Hecarim away, especially in a situation like that. Hecarim just from the side doesn't even run through the team. He just runs around the side, finds who he wants to find. And you can't stop it, honestly. There's not much you can do about it.
And now the gold lead is starting to look a little bit insurmountable at this stage. 8,000 in favor of GLB. If you're looking through the eyes of a Pariah player or, you know, a Pariah fan, where would you be screaming for them to go next? What is the call here for Pariah to pull themselves back into this game?
It's difficult to get back into the game when you've got a really good, in my opinion, late game team from GLB. Basically, this call key's not going to fall off much unless you have unless Maokai gets massive and he can just tank all the call key rockets. I don't think we're going to get to a point where that's going to happen. But maybe if Pariah can just stall out really far like that, and you can try it. But, I mean, Jhin is notoriously not that good versus tanks, and you're going to have a massive Hecarim frontline, a massive Shen frontline as well. Yeah. So, honestly, it's just, in my opinion, maybe getting catches on the squishies, like a massive shockwave or something like that as well. Probably going off of the, you know, the greed and the cockiness of GLB, which Rao's already shown a lot of, honestly, this game. So maybe getting some nice stuff, transitioning to Baron, whatever, that kind of stuff.
Well, certainly, you mentioned Baron just there. There's a lot of pressure on Baron right now from the side of GLB. It's certainly an objective they could be looking towards. Look at the damage onto Baranibus. That was a Sheena-powered auto-attack followed by a rocket, and that's two-thirds of his HP gone. Shinklin feeling the pressure as well. I mean, you mentioned this composition. Look at this. Hard engage comes through. Baranibus walks away just about with his life, as does Toxic. But there's a double taunt coming through. Double kill with a single rampage. Turn it into a triple for Trilife. And this is surely going to be the ace. Deity's got nowhere to go. The towers will be falling shortly as well. Delito walks away, but the minions are now here. This will be an inhibitor. 20 seconds on most of the respawns. They could maybe look at Nexus Towers, if not head to potentially the Baron.
Yeah, I mean, Corki pushes fast. They might get it. The minion, the death timers are not that high, so they're probably not going to go for it. But still, I mean, that comp is what I said. You know, you poke with the Corki, you poke with the Varus, and then you charge in with the Hecarim. Shen ults the Hecarim, and what do you do about it? You can't do anything about it. That's what you do about it. Maybe you look towards the alt key and the F4 key. Maybe that's what you do about it. But holy moly, like, this, I mean, there's so much poker's already gone down here. Hecarim just... You can't stop Hecarim charging in, and if people are on this low health from Pariah, you can't stop it. It's just because even if you deal with Hecarim, say you lock Hecarim down there, what do you do about Shen coming in afterwards?
Yeah, and I think one of the hardest things as well is the sheer wave clear on the side of GLB versus the lack thereof on the side of Pariah. Because yes, you've got Orianna, great wave clear, but your command protect is not enough to deal with the just piercing arrows on top of the rockets coming out from Vrout and Berserker. It's not enough. You can't just walk forward and clear the wave. So
whoa.
That,
goodbye.
Wow. That was a full HP Aoki there. That
was,
just,
yes.
That just got eradicated from the map.
Yeah, that's really tough to play against. I mean, he Corki gets ahead. and he just one shots you, as you can see. You know, I don't need to tell you that. You just saw it like five times in this game. You know, Corki is just insane. Yeah. Really, really strong mid laner right now.
That is going to be a second Cloud Drake as well, going the way of GLB. Obviously, Cloud Drake's never going to be the one that you're looking toward the most, but it's certainly nothing you're going to complain about controlling that objective. Supers will slowly but surely stop pushing at the top lane. Vrow once again just goes in. Toxic will surely go down as well. Curtain Call, but Delita will be able to block just about all of it. Trilly maybe bit off more than he can chew, but Stand United will keep him alive. Shockwave nice. Onto two. Maybe they can turn this one around. Aoki looking for the kills. Trilight does get finished off by the tower in the end, but that a singular kill in the trade for three. Delito still happy to tank this up. Doesn't get away though. Double kill comes through for Schicklin. They're just about holding on. They'll keep their inhibitor.
Yeah, this is one of those fights where if you're not so far behind, I think it goes pretty well for you on Pariah. A lot of blinking health bars usually means, yeah, this is where you just type unlucky in the chat, but if you weren't so far behind, you had more items, you had more damage, the enemy team was so tanky, you know, you probably win that fight. So that was a you know, greedy, in my opinion, from GLB to take that fight, but yeah, they're so far ahead, man. I mean, it's tough.
When you're Vrow right now on 9-3-5, it'd be difficult not to, you know, be a little bit greedy, to want to go for those kind of highlight reel plays, because, you know, so far this game, it's pretty much always paid off for him when he just jumps over a wall and one-shots someone. We've seen him do it. I mean, we saw him do it onto Aoki, like, what, a minute before that fight started, and that was how that fight started again. He just did it again, jumped on, I think it was Branibus this time around, but you can understand his confidence in the situation.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the thing with Corki as well, you can be extra confident because a lot of your damage comes when you're pretty far away. So when you do go in, they're already quite low. Although, to be honest, Vrow is so strong right now, he will jump in and just one-shot you anyway. But, you know, he is someone who, if you're going to go aggressive on, you probably get away with it, honestly, because you don't have to be in there for very long. You don't dedicate too hard to the play, basically.
Yeah, and especially if you've got the package, you can always just bulk out immediately afterwards. But we are going to see now Baron will be prepped by the side of GLB. 13,000 is the gold lead. Top lane inhibitor still pushing against Pariah, but it will be respawning fairly shortly, so only two or three more minion waves will come out of that one. Ultimate actually going to be used by Toxic Dez just to be able to scout out these players, but the Baron has already been started off. I really don't think there's much that's going to be able to happen here. Trilipe should be able to basically just ward off Toxic. He doesn't even have to be there for the smite. He just has to make sure Toxic's not.
Yeah, when your jungler is running interference on the Baron, you know that that Baron's pretty free. You know, usually you have someone else run interference so the jungler can secure it, but these guys are so far ahead, so confident in this play, that they just send Hecarim off to do it. Probably not the ideal person to do it. You know, you've got Corki, who'd probably be the best, just like loads of poke and stuff, but nah, whatever. You guys say Baron, I'm just going to walk around and spot out Rengar. You could argue it's a bit of a mind game. You know, if you the less people you see, including the jungler, the more you see, including the jungler, on the map, the less likely you believe Baron to be going down, because you think, oh, if they were doing Baron, the jungler would be there. But to be honest, I think that situation was just, go on then.
Yeah.
See if you can stop us.
Yeah, I feel like that
he
one
goes
was
mid.
Oh, here we go. Well, that's going to be the end of Branibus. That's a nice flash coming out, but it's not enough to escape. Yes, it is. Command Protect along with a heal from Aoki. Trilib is not done, though. Rampaging through the base right now. At this point, it feels like GLB are just about invincible in these fights. Berserker going to be able to take that top lane inhibitor once again. Trilipe heading down to the mid lane. This is just going to be cleanup crew coming through from GLB. This one is surely in the bag at this stage. That's two inhibitors down. They could go for the bottom lane, but they just don't need to. They can finish this game pretty safe and sound. So, Pariah, 1-0 down now in this series. Toxic Dares just padding his stats on that one. Finally getting a little bit of revenge on Berserker, ruining his perfect scoreline. But that is going to be double the kills and a win in the bag for